Well, welcome to this afternoon's public lecture. I'm Dan Reed. I'm the Vice President for Research and Economic Development here at the University of Iowa, but you didn't come to hear me. There's an old line from the astronomer Edwin Hubble, who described really the insatiable curiosity to understand our world. He said, "Our immediate neighborhood we know intimately, but with increasing distance, our knowledge fades. The search is older than history. It's not satisfied, and it won't be denied." I think that's a fitting description of the work that both Don and Bill have done over the last 40 plus years. It's the story, in both of their cases, of lives well lived, of satisfying a lifelong passion to understand. There's no exaggeration to say that a lot of what we know about the solar system today is due to the work of these two people. And that's what we're really here to celebrate, both of them and their accomplishments. But I want to talk specifically about Bill, because it's important to recognize what he has done as well. You know, Bill is the story of someone who found his lifelong passion at an early age. Yeah, he sat down, because I'm going to talk about him more than he thought about. And I'm going to try hard to embarrass him here. From the early days before Bill ever came to the University of Iowa, looking at auroras in the night sky, to coming here and meeting Don as an undergraduate, working on probes, to pleading with Don to let him stay when he finished graduate school to work on Voyager. It is, as I said, the story of a life well lived. Someone who found passion and lived that passion with excellence. Bill is, for those of you who know him, a mild and unassuming person, but that belies the talent, the excellence, and the extraordinary things that he's done in his life. And we're here to recognize both of them today. And it's with that I'd like to introduce Bill Kurth.
Wow, thank you.
You need this one too.
I need both of them.
Oh, okay.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. We're here today. We've been had a series of talks on people, Don's colleagues, some of his former students, and we're celebrating a career that's now 50 years long. I want to make sure that you all understand that this is not the end of a career. This is just a milestone. Don isn't retiring. But I would like to start by having Don stand up. You have to understand that about half of the room has been here all day, and I'm going to show slides that they've seen all day. I don't think they'll see anything new than what they've seen, but I realize that there's some newcomers to the audience, and some of you may not know, I don't understand how that would be possible, but you may not know Don Gurnett. We're here celebrating 50 years as a professor of physics here in at the University of Iowa. He's actually been here longer than that. He actually came to the university in 1957 to study electrical engineering. You might recall that James Van Allen started the space age by flying a Geiger tube on Explorer 1 in early 1958, and it wasn't very long after that that Don showed up on his doorstep saying, I want to work for your group, and he wanted to be involved in the space program. And he started working as an undergraduate on some of the very earliest space missions that the United States flew. He worked on the very first satellite that was built here at the University of Iowa. University of Iowa contrary to some people, in a state, two or three states from here, would west of here, would tell you, University of Iowa is the first university to build satellites, complete satellites, and fly them and control them here. Let's see, I want to make sure I don't forget something here. This picture here of Don with Engine 3, I called out Engine 3 not because it was his first mission, but I think it was the mission at which he made the decision to leave engineering and become a physicist. And so that was a cornerstone of his career. And of course, he's carried on. He's now working on Cassini and a number of other projects I'll talk about. I can't possibly cover all of the work he's done. He's written something like 600 papers, and I couldn't stand up here and just read the titles for you over that time period. He's mentored 63 graduate student theses. 29 of those are PhD students. Many of those are in the audience today. And let's see. He's also made observations with primarily his own instruments at 7 of the 8 planets. He hasn't gone to Mercury. But to make up for that, he has had instruments on the 2 Helios spacecraft, which is a joint US-German mission that sent spacecraft into about a third of an AU inside the orbit of Mercury. So he's actually covered that end of the solar system quite well. And as many of you know, he's also the principal investigator for an instrument on Voyager, which was instrumental in determining that Voyager has now crossed into interstellar space. There's a long list of projects over here that Don has played an important role in. Most of them, actually, he's been the principal investigator, meaning he's in charge. He's the one responsible for making sure those projects work. And as I said, he's co-authored a large number of papers. And one personal comment I would like to make is that I don't think, I've run into a number of eminent scientists across the world. There's many of them in this audience. But I don't think I've ever run into anybody who has the hunger and the thirst for understanding that Don has. He doesn't pick up a problem and put it down until he understands fully, at least in his mind, what's going on. And what's more, he doesn't stop there. He goes to the first person he finds and wants to explain to them what's going on. And I know that half the room has had meals with him, and each of those meals is an introduction in physics, whether it's plasma physics, fluid dynamics, or whatever. He will talk your ear off trying to explain to you the most recent thing that he's figured out. And in that sense, he's a very eminent professor and teacher. Okay, so let me start with Engine 3. Don and I talked about this earlier today. This is the third spacecraft that was built here at the University of Iowa. And there's a copy of it over here, and this white piece on top, this ring, is actually a magnetic loop antenna that he convinced Professor Van Allen that should be added to this particular mission. And it's for the purpose of studying what are called very low frequency waves in space. Now, I think this wasn't quite the first space measurements of these phenomena. There is another spacecraft called Alouette that was launched a little bit earlier. But Don has made a number of observations of what we now consider to be very basic planetary plasma waves, magnetospheric plasma waves, with this instrument. And the first one I'm going to talk about is Whistler's. Now, Whistler, I should say that I'm going to show a lot of data in a format that we call a frequency time spectrogram. So colors here represent intensity or loudness. Red is loud, blue is kind of the instrument background. The vertical axis is, I think, in all cases going to be frequency. In this case, it's a few kilohertz. And even for us older people, it's within the audio frequency range. And the time axis is on the bottom. For a lot of these are going to be time scales of a few seconds, tens of seconds. In one case, it's going to be about 30 years. And so this is how we record, how Don's instruments record measurements made in space of plasma waves detected by various antennas. And this particular phenomenon is called a lightning whistler. And it was first reported in 1894 by a guy named Preece, I believe, based on ground-based observations. And there was a fairly large number of observations of this phenomenon during World War I, where people would lay down long wire antennas on the ground, hoping to pick up telephone conversations from the enemy on the other side of the line of scrimmage. It wasn't until, I think, 1953 that Owen Story wrote a paper that explained the basic physics behind this. And basically what's happening is you have a stroke of lightning. And we all know what lightning is. It's a big flash of light in the sky. Well, that light is electromagnetic energy, and we see just the visible portion of that. We hear thunder, which is actually an acoustic wave generated by this discharge. But what we don't see or hear is the very broad radio spectrum that's generated at the same time. And these waves propagate in all directions. And some waves in the few kilohertz range will propagate upward. And when they get into the ionosphere, they mode couple into something that's appropriately called the whistler mode. And what's special about this mode is that the waves tend to propagate along Earth's magnetic field. And more importantly, or in additionally, the waves propagate faster at higher frequencies than they do at lower frequencies. So if you're out here on one of these magnetic field lines over a thunderstorm and you hear this radio emission come to the satellite, you don't hear a click, which is all frequencies getting to you at the same time. You hear a whistle. And in fact, Don's instrument on engine 3 measured these. Now, these whistlers propagate in kind of the clockwise sense. They're right-handed waves. They interact with electrons very easily that way, because electrons rotate around the magnetic field line the same way. There's another phenomenon that Don measured, if I can get to it. There we go. And these are now called proton whistlers, primarily because of the work of Don Gurnett. And you'll hear a very fast whistler or spheric, followed by these tones, maybe. So these are whistlers that are now interacting with the ions. And if the whistlers are rotating in one direction and the ions are going around the field line in another direction, it doesn't seem to work. And as part of his comprehensive exam, Don had to come up with an original problem and a solution and convince his thesis committee or his examination board that he had a plausible explanation for this. And he came up with an explanation that said that when these waves get to a certain point in the ionosphere, they will reverse their polarization and they'll become left-handed waves, and then they can resonate with the ions in the plasma. And in fact, we even used this theory. Don used this theory in some of the measurements that Voyager made in the Io Taurus at Jupiter. Okay, so I played to you some sounds, and you're going to hear a lot more before I'm done. And I'd like to say a little bit about how these sounds are recorded. Don invented the machine and the spacecraft that actually makes these recordings. But how you take an electromagnetic wave in space and turn it into a sound is kind of the purpose of this slide. And it's also part of what Steve Fuselier talked about in the last talk. I'm going to talk about a special mode of plasma that's, among all the modes in the plasma, is fairly simple to think about. Here we've got a plasma where we've got electrons, the green minus signs, ions, the red plus signs. This is kind of what composes a plasma, charged particles. And if you separate those slightly and you let them go, the ions are heavy and they don't move very much, but the electrons will execute simple harmonic motion, the pendulum theory, about their equilibrium position. Now, if you put a radio there with a means of detecting these signals, here I've got a very short antenna, and some of our antennas on our spacecraft are much shorter than we'd like, not quite this short. We can detect a waveform, and if we find out a way of getting that waveform to the ground, and there are ways that Don has done this, and we've done it digitally, get it into an amplifier, and then let the amplifier drive a speaker, you get sound. And this is what these waves sound like. So those were electron plasma oscillations upstream of Jupiter's Balshock, and I'll say a little bit more about what Jupiter's Balshock is. Now, this is a cartoon. It's actually taken from the Van Allen probe's logo. But this is a cartoon that's courtesy of James Van Allen. This is a depiction of Earth's radiation belt. This was the major discovery from the first US spacecraft, Explorer 1, that flew Dr. Van Allen's Geiger tubes. It turns out that the Engine 3 VLF experiment detected a radio emission called chorus. And these are waves that are generated, we now know they're generated in the radiation belts, largely because of some of the work that Don's done. These waves are propagating at such a frequency that they can resonate with the electrons in the radiation belts of Earth, at least the outer radiation belt. And they have two effects. The effect that's shown here is that waves will propagate, these electrons will just bounce back and forth from one hemisphere to the other ad infinitum until you shake them up a little bit. And the chorus waves shake them up. They accelerate them, in some cases, towards the atmosphere. And once the electrons hit the atmosphere, they're lost from the system. So this is a basic way of limiting the intensity of Earth's radiation belts. And it's these chorus waves that are responsible. It turns out that the chorus waves can also accelerate those electrons and make the electrons in the radiation belts more energetic. And these are recordings from Engine 3. If you've been here today, you've already seen and heard these. So, it sounds like chirps. The name chorus comes from a British term, dawn chorus, which is the sound of birds waking up in the morning. And so that's where they get their names. It's fun doing physics when you discover something new because you get to name it and you can use names that are quite fun to use. So just to show that chorus waves are not unique to the Earth, this is a sample of chorus in the magnetosphere of Uranus. These were obtained by the plasma wave instrument that Don engineered for the Voyager 1 and 2 spacecraft. Voyager 2 flew past Uranus and Neptune as well as Jupiter and Saturn. And this is what these waves sound like. So these waves tell us that the physics that occurs in Earth's radiation belts also occur at Uranus. This is evidence that Uranus has its own radiation belt. Now, Tom Kermegis' instrument on Voyager actually measured the radiation belts of Uranus, and also at Jupiter and Saturn and Neptune as well. So one thing that Voyager has shown us is that phenomena that we've discovered and studied here at Earth are actually common phenomena throughout the solar system. They occur in other planetary magnetospheres, planets that have their own intrinsic magnetic field, a magnetic bubble surrounding them. Now, another topic that Don picked up, I think he was studying this when I was an undergraduate or early graduate student. This is the subject of radio emissions that come from the Earth's auroral zone. And he used two of his experiments on interplanetary monitoring platforms 6 and 8. We call them IMP-6 and IMP-8 because if you work for NASA, you have to use acronyms. These observations were actually taken by the two of the cluster spacecraft. This is a cluster of four spacecraft flying in formation through Earth's magnetosphere. And the study that Gurnett carried out was not actually the discovery of these radio emissions. There is a Russian by the name of Benediktov that wrote a paper that mentioned high-pass noise and showed a spectrum, and that was about all he showed. Don did his homework, found out lots of things about where these emissions occur, where you can see them, where you can't, what the spectrum is, how they relate to various regions in the magnetosphere, and basically wrote the book on what he called terrestrial kilometric radiation. In that paper, he showed that there was a correlation between the occurrence of the northern lights, the auroras, and the intensity of these waves. And when I worked on these for my master's thesis, he says, don't use terrestrial kilometric radiation, call it auroral kilometric radiation. So it was Don's term. I was the one that got to put it in my paper. And there was a nice story earlier today about some discussions between our group and a group at Goddard Space Flight Center about what these should be called. I think Don won. So I'm going to play these. Now, in this case, even though the sounds that I've played for you already are at the frequencies they occur naturally in space, these have to be shifted downwards because these occur in the frequency range of 100 to 300 kilohertz, and obviously we can't hear that. So these have been shifted down, and these are actually in stereo because there's two spacecraft measuring basically the same phenomenon at the same time. Now, Don's heard this thousands of times, and he's still sitting over here smiling. So. Yes. Yes, I considered trying to put that system back together and decided I wasn't going to try. Now, one thing that you notice about these radio emissions is they have a lot of very discrete structure, and I would say that we don't really have a good explanation of all that discrete structure. But remember this discrete structure because it turns out that other planets have radio emissions too. And in fact, in 1955, two of the very first radio astronomy observers saw Jupiter in the sky. They worked very hard to demonstrate to themselves that they were actually seeing Jupiter and not some other object in the sky. And they actually detected what we can now call Jovian decametric radiation. All these features are named by their wavelength. In this case, the wavelengths are about 10 meters long. They're higher frequency than those at Earth. These were, as I said, discovered back in 1965. And one of the features of this emission is we now know it was conjectured quite some time ago, around the time that Don was doing his work, that they were generated at another special frequency of the plasma. I talked about plasma oscillations. Another special frequency of the plasma is the frequency that electrons rotate around the magnetic field. And these are generated at that frequency. That frequency is set only by the intensity or the strength of the magnetic field. So by measuring the frequency of these radio emissions, Burke and Franklin could tell us already what the magnetic field strength that Jupiter was. So we knew that Jupiter had a very strong magnetic field in its own magnetosphere long before the space age started. And this is just what we call a family portrait of some of the different types of radio emissions that Jupiter possesses. And I show a picture here of, this is a Hubble image of the ultraviolet auroras at, I think this is the north polar cap of Jupiter, showing that Jupiter has auroras just like Earth. In fact, they're much more powerful. These are the most powerful auroras in the solar system. And I'd like to point out this very special feature here. This is actually the footprint of Io. This is a special moon in the Jovian system. Voyager discovered that it had 8 or 9 volcanoes going off simultaneously during the Voyager flyby. And the existence of this aurora at its magnetic foot, this is where the magnetic field that passes through Io, then enters Jupiter, falls. You see there's a trail here. That's actually responsible for some of these radio emissions, the most intense ones. So Io is a very special moon. Jupiter's a very special place. And now that Don has discovered and told us about the radio emissions at Earth, we now know that planetary radio emissions exist at all the magnetized planets, including Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. And I've shown here a plot of the intensities of the radio spectrum of the planets. The red line here is Jupiter. There are many red lines because there's many components, as shown over here. This is Saturn's spectrum. Here's Earth down here in blue. It's kind of puny compared to Jupiter, but more intense than Uranus and Neptune. And for reasons that I don't think we know other than coincidence, Uranus and Neptune have very similar radio spectrum. Now, just to show that we actually do measure these radio waves at Saturn, this is a Cassini measurement of Saturn kilometric radiation as opposed to auroral kilometric radiation. It comes from Saturn. And first thing you'll notice that there's very discrete features here, and this is really kind of fun to listen to. So. So I should say that we have also done studies at Saturn similar to the ones that Don did at Earth that show the intensity of these radio emissions correlates with the intensity of the auroras on Saturn. So in fact, we have used the intensity of the Saturnian radio emissions to tell us about what the intensity, the state of the magnetosphere, how excited it is, whether it's being buffeted by the solar wind or not. These radio emissions have also been used to tell us something about rotational modulation at Saturn. I should say that starting as early as 1955, radio astronomers told us what the length of a day is on Jupiter. Now, you might say, well, of course we know the length of a day on Jupiter. But think about it. Jupiter and Saturn and Uranus and Neptune are all gas giants. All we see are clouds. We can't see a crater and count how long it takes for that crater to spin around. So we have a very long baseline of observations of Jupiter. Jupiter's magnetic field is offset and tilted from its rotational axis, so it wobbles, and the radio emissions are tied to that magnetic field, so it's a very good indicator of what the rotation of the planet is. Voyager measured a similar type of modulation at Saturn, and they measured a period of 10 hours, 39 minutes, 24 seconds with an error of about 7 seconds. The International Astronomical Union adopted that as the length of a day on Saturn. And then very quickly, some of our French colleagues flew a spacecraft called Ulysses, and we arrived there later with Cassini, and we verified that that's not the right period. It changed. It changed by 6 minutes. It's 6 minutes slower by the time Cassini arrived at Saturn. And very quickly realizing that Saturn's a very massive body and we always conserve angular momentum, this cannot be the rotation period of the deep interior of the planet. So we went with one problem at Saturn, and not understanding why Voyager found modulations in its radio period, since Voyager also found that the magnetic field at Saturn, unlike Earth and Jupiter, which is offset or tilted, Saturn's magnetic field is very highly aligned with the rotational axis of Saturn. And I'm happy to say I have two magnetometer scientists here in the room, Margie Kibbleson from UCLA and Michelle Doherty from Imperial College, who's the PI of the Cassini magnetometer. They've measured and measured and measured trying to find an anomaly, an asymmetry in this magnetic field, and there just isn't one. So why is there a spin period? Why is there a spin modulation in these radio periods? And furthermore, how long is a day on Saturn? We really don't know. I guess I could play this. Maybe. There we go. Okay, so clearly I haven't told you the time scale here. Each one of those arrows is 10 hours and 45 minutes apart. So this is several days worth of data. And it's not a very fun sound to listen to, but it does demonstrate how one would use this type of modulation to determine the rotation period. In fact, this is used to study the rotation of pulsars, actually. Now, Don has an instrument on the Mars Express mission that's in orbit at Mars. This is a European mission that the US cooperated with. There's a radar sounder. In fact, Don Kirshner, sitting back here in the audience, built the transmitter for this sounder experiment. Part of the experiment is designed to look at the subsurface of Mars, trying to find evidence for liquid water. The part of the experiment that Don is interested in is called an ionospheric sounder. This instrument basically transmits a signal downwards towards the planet, and when it hits the ionosphere, the waves can't propagate through that ionosphere. They reflect, and if you measure the delay time from when you sent the signal, you can tell how far below the satellite that layer is. So this tells us about the ionosphere. At higher frequencies, the ionosphere doesn't get in the way and you get a reflection from the surface. And, well, lo and behold, there is another reflection that came from apparently below the surface. But what really happened, and Don figured this out, is that there are bumps in the ionosphere, and that while you may be relatively close to the ionosphere directly below you, you can get reflections off one of these bumps that give a much longer delay time. And as the spacecraft either approaches or recedes, that delay time will vary. So these are called oblique ionospheric echoes. And Don and his team on Mars Express have been studying these and a large number of other phenomena with the Mars Express experiment. I talked about the plasma oscillations upstream of Jupiter's Balshock. Let me say a little bit about what a Balshock is. All of the planets are bathed in something we call the solar wind. The sun is a source of plasma that very quickly gets accelerated to speeds of 1,000,000 miles per hour, sometimes even twice that. And this this wind blows past all the planets. It's supersonic in the same way that a supersonic aircraft is that flies faster than the speed of sound in the atmosphere will create a sonic boom. Or in this case, this is a diagram showing a shock that's set up in front of a bullet that's traveling at supersonic speeds in our atmosphere. It turns out, even though this is a charged gas, there's still an analogous effect of a sonic boom. We call it a bow shock when it's upstream of a planetary magnetosphere. And Voyager actually captured the sound of the turbulence. What's going on here is the solar wind is moving so fast it runs into an obstacle. Something has to slow it down, deflect it around the obstacle, turns out it heats the gas as well. And it's these plasma waves play a role in that. This particular recording doesn't, you can't hear the plasma oscillations. I have another one I like better, but I couldn't get it to work with this particular movie. So let me play this. You'll see Voyager moving towards the bow shock. There's a couple of sounds here that are actually the spacecraft, not Jupiter. Now, I have a hard time listening to this, and this is our favorite recording, I think. But I have a hard time listening to this without thinking about standing on a beach in Hawaii and having a breaker come across the beach and splash over me. So, when you get into Jupiter's magnetosphere, Jupiter has a very low-density outer magnetosphere. There's actually a cavity there. And another type of radio emission that Don discovered at Earth, called he called it trapped continuum radiation, occurs in the Jovian magnetosphere as well. That's this fuzzy region up above here. You'll see there's a very sharp demarcation. That's the plasma frequency. That's the frequency that if there were plasma oscillations that we would find those at. Instead, we see these kind of discrete tone structures. This is kind of a little bit more complex form of a plasma oscillation. This is what happens when you have a magnetized plasma, and now you have the electrons moving in a magnetic field as well. They tend to get intense right around the electron plasma frequency, and as is the case in the solar wind, these waves, the frequency of these waves, tell us the density in the magnetosphere, and in this region of the magnetosphere, Jupiter, the density is about 0.1 particles per cubic centimeter. So, you know, volume about like this, you'll find one electron. Okay. Margie Kibbleson gave us a very nice description of these data earlier today. Galileo had a plasma wave instrument on it, and for various reasons, its mission was to not only study Saturn and its magnetosphere and the moons around the moons of Saturn, but it was designed to repeatedly fly past the Galilean satellites. Callisto, Ganymede, Europa, and Io. And this is our first satellite flyby. These are data that Galileo acquired during that time, and I'm going to play these for you. Now, you probably noticed that there's some peculiar features about these plasma waves. Don recognized a lot of these plasma waves as analogs to what we measure in Earth's magnetosphere. These banded structures, for example, are called electron-cyclotron harmonic emissions, and they're at harmonics, well, between harmonics of this special frequency I mentioned is the cyclotron frequency of electrons. These emissions, some of them are coarse, and a related emission called plasmaspheric hiss that we also see at Earth. Don looked at this and said, there's a magnetosphere here. Ganymede has its own magnetosphere. Ganymede's embedded deep within the largest structure in the solar system, Jupiter's magnetosphere, and it has its own magnetosphere. So this is profound. Margie pointed out that one of the implications of this discovery is that here's an icy moon of Jupiter that must have a dynamo that's working inside, which means the interior of the planet must not be frozen solid. There must be currents of some conductive fluid going through. It's a very profound measurement. I should say that Margie had the magnetometer on Galileo, made measurements at the same time. And I think there is a phone conversation between Don and Margie where they compared the intensity of the magnetic field, and I think Don had it right within a factor of two or something like that. So, got a little bit further into the magnetosphere of Jupiter, and we discovered these. Brian Strayer's back here. He wrote his master's thesis on these, but see if you can figure out what these are. Now, if that sounds familiar, it should be. These are lightning whistlers at Jupiter. And at the time these measurements were made, we were unaware that lightning existed anywhere beyond Earth's atmosphere. So this was the discovery of an atmospheric phenomenon that's common now to Earth and Jupiter. And in fact, I'll show some observations from other planets. It says lightning is actually a fairly common phenomenon throughout the solar system. At about the same time the cameras were turned around to take a picture of the dark side of Jupiter, this was the time exposure. These are auroras up here, but these splotches down here are actually clouds that are lit from below by lightning strokes. So nearly simultaneous, although I think we were first. We reported, along with the imaging team, the existence of lightning on Jupiter. Lightning at Saturn. Now, it turns out that at Saturn, in fact, one of the talks earlier today actually played the one and only whistler that we've detected from Saturn, from Cassini. Tom showed that. It turns out that Cassini, we don't think Cassini's actually been in the right location to be in a good location to detect whistlers. But lightning detects, lightning also emits much higher frequency emissions that can propagate straight through the ionosphere. They don't couple into this funny whistler mode. And if you've ever driven through Iowa or any other state that has thunderstorms in your car, trying to listen to the Cubs baseball game on an AM radio station, and there's a thunderstorm nearby, you can't hear it because there's too much static. Well, it turns out Saturn produces static too. And it's from lightning deep within its atmosphere. And we've tried to recreate what that would sound like in your AM radio. I'm having trouble here. It's not going to stop for me. Sorry. Okay. Now, it turns out one of the episodes during which we detected these radio emissions from lightning is associated with this humongous storm. This started, I think, in December of 2011 and lasted for 6 months or so. We have a colleague who's in Austria, Georg Fischer, who's our expert on studying these radio emissions, and he's made a cottage industry out of studying these lightning radio emissions. This particular storm is similar to other very large storms that have been observed on Saturn over the last 180 years or so. You get one of these about every 20 or 30 years. That's about once per Saturn year. And now some of our friends at Caltech have determined that what's happening in the atmosphere of Saturn is you get water molecules high in the atmosphere and you start getting convection. You get convective storms. That's what a thunderstorm is. And you get lightning. Well, every once in a while you get a huge storm and basically all the water molecules in the upper atmosphere rain out to lower altitudes. So you're left with a situation where the heavy molecules are low in the atmosphere, the light molecules are high in the atmosphere, and it's a very stable situation, and you have to wait literally decades before you have another large storm like this. This is a whistler at Neptune. We had to think about this for quite a long time because it's got such a long dispersion. That means it propagated a very long distance through a very dense plasma. But I think we finally came to the conclusion that this is the most likely explanation of this radio emission. So all the planets that we visited seem to have lightning, except for maybe Venus. Now, we have a colleague at UCLA who would argue vehemently with this presentation, but we flew by Venus twice with the Cassini instrument on its way to Saturn. We looked for the same type of static radio emissions that I played for you from Saturn as we flew by Venus. And what we did was we did an experiment when we were far from Venus. We looked at fluctuations in the radio receiver to see what natural fluctuations are just in the electronics, so that we wouldn't be looking at something and say, okay, this must be lightning, when it really wasn't. And this line here basically indicates what that, it's basically a statistical probability of finding a fluctuation in the receiver when there really isn't one. These dots here represent the detection of lightning at Earth when we flew by Earth. These other symbols down here represent the rate at which we found these fluctuations when we flew by Venus. And our conclusion was that at least when we flew by Venus twice with Cassini, we did not see lightning. Okay, let me switch gears a little bit. When we launched Voyager, we had no idea we were launching a dust detector. But this is a little PR video that the Jet Propulsion Lab, with help from Don, put together. It's depicting the arrival of Cassini at Saturn when it went into orbit. We had to cross through the ring plane fairly close to the main ring system. And what you're hearing is the sound of literally hundreds of tiny dust particles hitting the spacecraft at speeds of 15 or 20 kilometers per second. And we didn't damage the spacecraft. These are dust particles that are the size of the particles in cigarette smoke. But they have so much kinetic energy that when they hit the spacecraft, they immediately destroy themselves and actually a little part of the spacecraft, and create a gas that's about 100,000 degrees. That's hot enough to ionize the gas. And I think there's still a debate going on as to how it is our instrument actually detects these signatures. But the simple explanation is our electric antennas collect some of these electrons that are produced from the impacts, and we see an impulse. And it's very easy to count these impulses, and we can come up with a flux of dust as we fly through the ring planes there. Now, this is a schematic showing the trajectory of Voyager 2 through the magnetosphere of through very close to Neptune. This is what we call a cylindrical coordinate system. Basically, we come inwards in radial distance. We go through the ring plane, and then we come back down, and we go through the ring plane again. And this is what we heard, I hope. I think we decided that Neptune was the dustiest place we'd been, based on the signatures that we found. It's an interesting note that when we were building Voyager to be launched, Saturn was the only planet in the solar system that had a ring system, and one of the things that Voyager was going to try to find out was, why is that? Why is Saturn special? Why does it have a ring? By the time we ended up flying past all the planets, either telescopically from Earth or observations from Voyager showed us that all the outer planets, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, all have rings. Saturn has the most beautiful and most extensive ring system, but they all have. So then the question is, why don't all the other planets? Okay, now I want to talk a little bit about the Helios observations, because they represent the innermost observations of some of Don's instruments. And I've talked about plasma oscillations. This is instability in the plasma when the electrons are displaced. Steve Huseley gave a much better explanation of plasma oscillations and how they're really created in a space plasma. I'm not going to go into that. But one of the outcomes of Don's Helios research was to show that these were much more intense, closer to the sun than further from the sun. And I think this is probably related to the energy density in the plasma as a function of radial distance. Another thing that is very important is that Don found evidence of these plasma oscillations, that's these very bursty things, simultaneous with the detection of a solar radio emission called type 3 radio bursts. Another fantastic name, type 3. Why wouldn't you come up with that name? It turns out that the ongoing theory for the generation of these type 3 radio bursts is that it's coupling from this electrostatic plasma oscillation mode that we've been talking about to freely propagating radio waves. And that's a topic that I don't really want to try to explain to you, but nevertheless, that was the going theory, and these were observations that showed that that process was actually going on. Now, that's a great introduction to this last topic that I want to cover. These are what we call heliospheric radio emissions. Now, if you look at the frequency scale here, this is these occur from about 1.8 kilohertz up to about 3.5 kilohertz. And we didn't see these until we got beyond the Saturn encounter, well beyond 10 astronomical units. The reason we didn't see these is that electromagnetic waves, freely propagating electromagnetic waves, cannot propagate below the plasma frequency in the plasma. At the Earth, the plasma frequency in the solar wind is 25 kilohertz. There's no way we could detect these. It's not until we get beyond the order of Saturn that these waves can even get close enough to the sun to reach a detector, like Voyager, when it's at that radial distance. And we started detecting these radio emissions. And on this time scale, this goes from 1982 to 2014, I guess, 2015. You can't see the detail here, but there are rising radio tones in these emissions that go on for months and months and months. This is the longest lived radio emission that I think anybody's ever detected, one individual element. We almost immediately suspected that electron plasma oscillations were the source of these. When we got to this event here, Don had figured the problem out almost completely. He used the occurrence of very strong solar storms that occurred just about 400 days before this event and 415 days or so before this event to figure out, okay, these are the two most intense solar periods of solar activity that we've seen in the last, since the space age started, and these are the two most intense radio emissions we've seen with Voyager out in the outer heliosphere. There must be a connection. Did a time of flight study and said that, okay, if you launch something at the Earth and this disturbance propagates out through the solar wind, it will get to wherever these radio emissions were ignited 400 days later. Knowing the speed of these disturbances, he calculated, I think, somewhere between 125 and 160 astronomical units for the distance to where these were generated. Now, where they are generated, they have to be generated in a plasma that can support a plasma frequency of a few kilohertz. In the outer heliosphere, the density of the plasma supports plasma oscillations of maybe a few hundred hertz. It's a density that's a factor of 50 or 100 lower than you need to create these radio waves. So Don said, these must be generated beyond the heliopause because beyond the heliopause you can have a much denser, it'll be a cold plasma, but you'll have a much denser plasma. So the source must be on the heliopause, and we're going to predict that we'll see plasma oscillations there, and the density of the plasma is going to be about 0.1 per cubic centimeter. And in fact, the astronomers had already told us that that would be the density that we should expect, so that wasn't actually an original prediction. But I've kind of shown the final answer here. Out here after 2012, we're seeing emissions that we have determined are electron plasma oscillations. So you can imagine seeing these things for the first time in 1982 or 83, wondering where they come from, saying, okay, they must come from plasma oscillations a long ways out. and waiting 30 years to find out whether you're right. Now this is a computer model of this heliosphere that I've talked about. The sun's in the middle, and this lighter region, it represents the supersonic solar wind moving out at 1,000,000 miles per hour. Coming in from the right side here is the interstellar wind, and there's kind of a blunt boundary here, which we call the heliopause. Now, the details of this model is subject to discussion among scientists, but don't worry about that. It turns out that Hubble's actually taken pictures of these things. This is a picture, and I believe these are images from the Orion Nebula. I'm not positive about that. But you can see this bullet-shaped object here, and if you look really closely, there's another one up here. So we're reasonably sure that stars have astrospheres, that our sun has a heliosphere, and the idea is that we've now crossed this boundary. And here are the plasma oscillations, drawn dashed lines to kind of indicate what's going on in between the events. We need something to trigger these, and it's events coming from the sun that trigger these. So I think what's phenomenal about this observation is that I think there were people in our community that thought once we crossed the heliopause, we'd be in this kind of gray soup that would never change, or there'd be never anything going on in it and be very boring. It's anything but that. Another thing is that you see that there's variations in the density here. One of Don's students, Steve Fuselier, wrote a paper around the time these were discovered, saying that we should expect what's called a depletion layer just beyond the heliopause. And in fact, we think this is evidence of that depletion layer. I should say, and Don, you can tell me if I shouldn't say, but we've started to detect a fourth emission. It's even more intense than any of these three. We were kind of afraid that we'd see these go out to several astronomical units, and then they'd peter out. But the most recent one that's just started a few weeks ago, is even more intense than these three that we have here. We haven't got this type of data back from the spacecraft yet. These data get recorded and played back every few months, and I think the next playback is on November 12th, so we're anxiously waiting to see those data. They'll tell us where in this density range the spacecraft happens to be. So, congratulations, Don. These are three Hubble images of Saturn with images of the UV aurora superimposed on them, and I'm going to close my talk by playing you some more sounds of Saturn kilometric radiations. And if you want a copy of these to play at Halloween, you're welcome. This goes on for a long time, so I'm going to stop it, I think. So. Now, I think it's unfair that I've stood up here and talked about what Don's done in his career when he's sitting right here. So I thought maybe it would be appropriate to have him stand up and tell me everything I said that's wrong, and also help field questions from you if you have questions for either one of us. So Don, would you like to stand up?
Okay. I'll do that. Well, thanks a lot for a great summary. I'll tell you, Bill used the name Don a lot, and let me just say that I didn't do this alone. There was a great support group, and many people not only worked with me, but on other spacecraft projects. I'd like to have anybody who worked in the space program here raise their hand. Yeah, we have.
Okay, I'm being wired up here. I didn't really intend to say much more than that, actually. For Jim Van Allen and his group right after the launch of Explorer 1 as an engineer. And I eventually got converted to doing physics. And I think there was, somebody said 63, but I think it's 62 students that I've advised their thesis projects over the years. And I'll have to tell you, working with those students, I mean, I gained as much out of it as they did. I hope in all cases, that it was a close cooperative deal. I think you heard that from some of the students here. There's quite a few of my former students here, and many of them have had with careers that went on in other universities at the head of, or not the head of NASA, but very high positions in NASA. I think there must be at least three or four. Yeah, sorry, Jim. You're not quite the head of NASA, but you're doing pretty good, I would say. Jim Green here is the head of planetary at NASA headquarters. And I'm just going to guess at your budget. I mean, is it like $7 or $8 billion a year or something like that? I mean, these are the... You wish. Well, we're going to have to get that up higher. Let's not everybody politic on that. But there's others I just enjoy.
Right
by
Donald Trump.
Yeah. Anyway, this occasion has really been a blast because last night we had this reception and just the time we've had here, I've been able to talk to people here I haven't seen for like 50 years. Mike Weimer, it was more than that. I guess it was 55 years or something. And I don't know, I don't want to single people out here like this, but Gene Crossett. He's around here someplace. He worked with me on various things, decoding data, and he's a minister now. I'm not sure how his time with me turned him into a minister. By the way, there was another guy there. Those that were here during my talk, Cleo Hansen. He was the guy that had these. That wrote this real stringent memo about working 18 hours a day and all that stuff. Well, he was a minister while working here. So I seem to have been surrounded by some of those guy types. Look, I don't have anything more except to just say there's so many people I work here. It wasn't done alone. And just a lot of crucial things, a lot of problems that we solved together. Oh my, sometimes we get together and we talk about, you remember when that happened? Stuff like that. I don't want to think about those things. so any questions? Yes.
Thank you for the opportunity. I had the good fortune of meeting Don when I was completing my undergraduate degree. And we both had lunch frequently at Pearson's Pub.
I remember that.
Now, I didn't have any idea who Don was. I'm not a scientist.
I'm just a guy eating at Pearson's.
Talking about these space probes that took hours for the signals to go from the probe to Earth and back from Earth to the probe, it amazed me. So we are here to celebrate your scientific discoveries, but I want the group also to know that you are a very warm and caring person, and that's what attracted me to you in the first place.
Thank you.
Now, that being said, again, I'm not a scientist, but you've been talking about plasma, and I don't have a clue, or I didn't have a clue, but I'm guessing that this is some type of energy that is developed or projected from our heavenly bodies or planets. Would that be close to describing that?
Let me clarify that. A plasma is an ionized gas consisting of ions and electrons. The fluorescent light tube up here has a plasma in it. They're typically conductors, so it's not blood plasma. We'll make sure we get that clear. And yes, that's what I've specialized, it's turned out, in my scientific career. There's a book, Introduction to Plasma Physics, I can recommend to you if you want.
By the way, I would like to make a comment. We were very concerned about what was going to happen to Don Gerson's clothes.
Yeah, my secretary knew where to find me at 10:30 in the morning or something like that. But I've given up coffee since then. I don't drink coffee anymore, and pretty much only water. I might say, you know, just for advice to the university, I showed that memo that said what the working hours for students. You know, none of us went binge drinking during that time. That would be a real way to counteract the binge drinking thing here. Get a big space program going here with real tight schedules. By the way, that schedule thing, you really got to let that sink in. Because I didn't say that during my talk, but like Engine 1, which was launched in 1960, I think, on a Navy rocket, they had a weighted model, I mean mechanical model of Engine 1 there to bolt in, just a dummy, in case we didn't make it at the launch schedule. That was the first one that really had a tight schedule, but like Voyager 1 and 2, that was the grand tour, went to Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. I better get those in order. And that was called the Grand Tour. Those four planets were lined up in just the way you could do that. You know, they're all going around the sun at a different rate. And we had to launch in late August, early September, in order to get on a trajectory that could do that mission. And if you didn't achieve that, you weighed 179 years, I believe. I forgot the number. Yeah, so this is really high-stakes business we do here, and I'll have to tell you, it still is. And everything has to be done right, no mistakes. And I try to get my students to realize that in just courses I'm teaching. Like if, you know, you have an assignment for a paper to write, and there's a due date, I just kind of remind them when they actually graduate what they might face out in industry or NASA as far as certain deadlines. For example, I'm going to talk too long here, but for example,
there's a deadline, Don.
Yeah. NASA puts out an announcement. This is very organized now. Back in the early days, it wasn't like this at all. But NASA now puts out an announcement of opportunity, and that's to fly on a certain mission. I don't know what the next one's going to be, but the Europa mission, right. And they have a deadline on that. It has to be turned in at midnight some certain day. And if your proposal doesn't get there by that time, you're out. And that's because the lawyers check that date, and you may have the best proposal in existence, but it's gone. Is that right, Jim?
Yeah.
That's right. Okay, not many students in here that I see right now, but I want to try to get that across. Sometimes there's deadlines. All right, I'll be quiet.
Yeah, I distinctly remember talking you out of a plasma physics exam because we convinced you it was going to snow.
I don't remember that, and I don't admit to that. Okay, that way. Unless there's more questions or something. Yeah, there might be embarrassing questions.
Thanks for letting me stay around.
Oh, yeah. Did I ever have an issue with you staying around?
The back story of this is that I literally defended my PhD thesis in January of 1979, and Voyager 1 was going to arrive at Jupiter in February of 1979. And I said, I'd worked on the instrument, I'd helped calibrate it, and I asked Don, can I stick around to see what happens? And I'm still here. And Voyager's still flying, and it sounds like our instrument might actually last until 2030 now.
I'm not up on the latest date they might have to turn.
They had been telling us the last instrument would have to be turned off in 2025 because of power reasons. The last meeting we were at, they think we might be able to stretch it to 2030. Now, we don't know which instrument that is, and Tom's over here growling at me because he has an instrument, but our instrument only takes a watt. So, you know, when you get down to that last watt, it's going to be us or nobody.
Let me just run them back here. But let me say, probably the limiting factor, or at least a serious factor, is telemetry. We're getting farther and farther from the sun. In fact, do you realize how far it takes 18 hours, or roughly 18 hours, for a radio signal to come back at the speed of light? Speed of light, about a second to the moon. Just think about that. But we're getting so far away that now, to play back our data on the tape recorder, which is our crucial data, our most important data, it takes a 70-meter, that's a 210-foot diameter, absolutely, absolutely huge antenna, plus two 30-meter antennas. And it's actually, the data is getting a little bit ratty. You know, there's a long time here. Yeah, true. And they're going to have to go to 70-meter antenna plus three 30-meter antennas to get our data down. And that's going to turn into a struggle with NASA. And Jill, I'll let you on my side.
What bitrate are you getting there now?
We get 1.4 kilobits per second. Now, the interesting thing.
For the engineering part, the regular is 162.
Yes, but our high rate data comes down at 1.4 kilobits per second, which is like a 1200 baud modem. The interesting thing is the slowest playback speed of the recorder is 7.2 kilobits per second. So you might wonder how they do that. Well, it turns out they play back what basically is a line of an image. Our data sits in the same format as the Voyager images do. And so we get one of those lines with our data encoded in it. And the next four off the tape recorder just go into deep space. They don't go anywhere. And then after that's done, they read out another line that comes down to the Earth, and they skip the next four. So we're getting literally one-fifth of the data that's recorded because they can't play it back faster.
And I think we can't go lower on the bit rate. Is that true? I don't think so. Sorry. So we're...
the last year...
It moves out a year per year, I think.
3.5 AU per year.
Well, I think, Don, you should tell a little bit of a story about how you got over there.
Oh, boy. Yeah, we... Okay. No, I have to have both of them, okay. All right. This is beyond my capability, I think.
Just hold them.
Okay. Yeah, I guess I have two hands, don't I? Well, we sent in a proposal, I think it was about 1970, I'm not exactly sure about that, but that was turned down. And I don't know if I can even remember the reason it was turned down. That was for the Grand Tour mission. And we continue to struggle with NASA headquarters. I've learned a rule, actually, in my life, that persistence pays off. And we kept pushing and pushing. And it began to be, I guess it was Pioneer 10 got to Jupiter and measured the radiation belt. And they began to realize, like we had been saying, that plasma waves are important in the loss of particles from the radiation belt. And some people that are now deceased, John Simpson in particular, made a big appeal to NASA headquarters. And about then, there was another French instrument, Blamont, and that was a UV instrument, and he had gotten into some kind of trouble. And I don't mean, you know, I don't know what kind of trouble he was in, but basically there were some issues with regard to the instrument they could produce. And so they took his instrument off and put our instrument on. And that was on a pretty short time schedule. I don't remember the dates, but it was launched in 77, and that was probably around 73 or 74, which was pretty. Hey, should we keep going telling stories? Let me tell you about
The amount of data we were supposed to get back at Jupiter, I don't know if I can remember the right number, but they gave us like 1 minute of high rate data. Was it something like that?
48 seconds.
48 seconds, wasn't even a minute. That's what they promised us. And now I remember going out and talking with the engineers. I'm an engineer and I've often done this stuff. Go find out details. Don't talk to managers. Get in there and find out how it works. And I realized that we could, if we designed our data to look, now the imaging data went on the tape recorder. That's what the tape recorder was for. Maybe some other thing, but primarily imaging data. And so I found out what the format was, the digital format for inserting tape recorder data into the tape recorder. And I arranged to set our format of our data to match the imaging data. So there would be just one switch that you could switch over, and it would take our high rate data, that exact stuff you're listening to here. Now, but still, once that was agreed to, they were worried about failures on the switch. And we were given, 48 seconds worth of data at Jupiter. I mean, that's almost, well, you know, it wasn't, I don't want to say worthless,
it's
but it's not
none.
Very, better than none, right. But people at NASA headquarters have always known that I've managed to weasel around and, you know. And we had an absolute great luck during the approach to Jupiter, because when they first started transmitting images, the ground data decoder would lose sync. And here's why. They would take a picture, put it on the tape recorder. No, that was transmitted real time. That was real time, that's right. They transmitted real time. And then when they would slew the camera to a slightly different position, there was no data coming out of the imager. And so that just went from, you know, like it would be 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1 and all that, all of a sudden it'd go to 0. Now, to synchronize a data system, you have to have bit transfers, bit changes. I hope you can all see that. It's got to change or else you can't keep the ground decoder locked up. And so the thing would go out of lock. And I don't remember which of us did this, but I feel like it was me. I said, we can provide you like random noise. Just switch it to the wideband instrument because it puts out zeros and ones, and that'll cure your data sync problem. And that's what they did. And we got tremendous amounts of data because every time they would slew the camera from one, you know, one frame to the other, they had like a minute or two to get the camera slewed.
It's even worse than that, Don.
All right.
The reason they didn't take images continuously is because they had a budget for how many images they could process.
Oh, my God.
So they would take every fourth image because they couldn't process more.
Yeah. Well, we just got tremendous amounts of this wideband data during the Jupiter flyby. And, you know, that got our foot in the door. Yeah. I suspect we got more data than imaging ever did.
That's true on Cassini, that's not true on Voyager.
Yeah, I'll give you another example of how I was able to do that kind of stuff. On Cluster, there were four spacecraft. And Stan Shawn, too bad he isn't here. He was at NASA headquarters then. After a lot of finagling, like for example, on like the day before Christmas, they sent a note to me that said, well, you've been tentatively selected, but you can submit your final and best proposal. That's the day before Christmas, and it was due like the 4th of January. So what happens to your weekend? So they finally put my wideband instrument, which transmits this kind of stuff, on one spacecraft. Stan privately told me, we know you can get it on more than one. And also it was for a very small amount of data. And finally I convinced him that, well, we have to build a spare instrument. We always build a spare instrument. And why just let the instrument sit in the laboratory here? And this was a European project, part of my 300 trips across the Atlantic I mentioned. And finally, I convinced the project management to not just waste that instrument on the ground, but put it on the other one. put it on two of the four spacecraft. Well, it didn't end there. Another 6 months or so go by. And myself and the project scientist got scheming over the Rudy Schmidt. And he realized that during the testing program on the ground, that it would screw up their testing program if the spacecraft were even a little bit different. And of course we said, you're going to have to provide two more, which we did. But the bad news was when the Ariane 5 was the test flight of the French Ariane 5 rocket, and it blew up. We've had experiences like that. And so then there was a big political push to get NASA and Europe to build another set of clusters. And now we were in, we were on all four, and that's history. Okay, I'd like to tell stories.
Okay. Anybody here who has worked for this guy ever heard him accept the answer, no? I don't see any hands.
I told you an important principle in life, persistence. Remember that word, persistence. If you get a no, keep trying. Okay.